Great. I'm gonna read something to you, but before I do, I kind of want to give you a little heads up on the message. The message is called "Balance is not a bad word." It's not a cuss word. Amen. But the problem is when people try to balance grace with law, that's not balance. That's mixture. Amen. So the goal today is to come on and answer some of the tough questions, like turn the timer on. Is it okay that I'm under grace? Is it okay just to live a life of sin? Is that okay? No. If God's not rejecting you and he's already judged you for sin and he has, then why can't I just go out and do whatever? Well, there's natural consequences. We're going to get into this, okay? And we're going to answer it before the message is over. I'm going to pose it again after I read what I want to read to you, and then we're going to answer it from the Word of God, not my opinion. Isn't that good? I don't want my opinion. I want the truth. The truth is a person. His name is Jesus. Amen? The Word is truth. You know, when you love the Word, you love Jesus. When you see Jesus in the Word, they're one. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All right, I want to read this from Joe McIntyre. Who knows Joe McIntyre? No, he's a pastor in Washington State, I think Kirkland, somewhere out there around there. And he wrote the excellent book, E.W. Kenyon's autobiography, entitled E.W. Kenyon, The True Story. But anyhow, this is something he wrote that I thought was really good. He said, "So many in the church are waiting until they get their act together to come to the Father." Like I always say, if you get your act together, it's still an act. But Jesus has made the way for those still struggling with their humanity to come and find grace to help. Trying to live the Christian life in the power of the flesh is a recipe for frustration and defeat. It cannot be done. Observe how Paul describes the superiority of grace and righteousness in the new covenant over the frustration of wrestling with sin's power when we live in our own strength. In order that as sin has exercised kingly sway in inflicting death, so grace too may exercise kingly sway in bestowing a righteousness which results in the life of the ages through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's Romans 5:21 from the Weymouth Translation. Faith takes hold of the grace of God by accepting the gift of righteousness and coming to God for more grace as needed. The unrenewed mind struggling with the sense of failure and defeat that trying to get your flesh to do God's will inevitably leads to, or knows, continual frustration and its poor performance. In other words, it knows it doesn't measure up. The new nature within you longs to do God's will. Just like those guys getting married. What is that? I never said a thing to them. I'm not here to make you live right. I'm here to point you to Jesus and who you are in Christ. That's it. And you do what you want. Just don't hurt anybody. But if you get a hold of who you are in Christ, you will live so right. You'll live holier accidentally that way than you ever did on purpose in your own strength. Let me finish this. The new nature within you longs to do God's will. You were created, or perhaps we should say recreated, to live in the gift of righteousness and to be empowered by his grace. It's good news. Amen. Start your day at the throne of grace. Your Father is waiting for you. Jesus has made the way. Receiving grace is the key to transformation. Come by God's new and living way, Jesus. Let grace reign. Let me say this to you. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse 17, it talks about we receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. We reign in life by one Jesus Christ. Now, let me say this to you. Receiving in the Greek is in the present tense. That means we keep receiving it. Thank you, Jen. My frog, I'll keep on this side. We keep receiving it. Amen? It's not a one-time thing. You know there's commandments in the New Testament? You know, like being filled with the Spirit is a commandment? It's not that you're not going to, if you're born again, you're righteous with him. But if you're not, it has the in the Greek, it has to do with the idea of allowing the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to control you. In other words, if I'm not allowing him to control me, Jesus to be Lord through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. If I'm not allowing that, then guess what? God's not my Savior. You know, if you confess Jesus as Lord, then he becomes your Savior. You got that? Not if you confess him as Savior. Anybody hear the difference? A lot of people want to confess Jesus as Savior and then still be their own Lord. This is a good news because everything God has for you is way better than you have for yourself. Amen. See, well, because we don't believe that. We don't understand how good he is. Psalm 34, verse 8, "Oh, taste and then see that the Lord is good. Blessed is that man who trusts in him. But you got to taste before you'll ever see and before you'll ever trust. See, we tell people, oh, just trust in God, but they don't know him. Amen. And if you don't know him, it's hard to trust somebody you don't know. Amen. All right. Balance is not a bad word. Say that. Balance is not a bad word. It's not a cuss word. Acts chapter 20. Let's go there. Let's start with about verse 26. And I'm just prepping this because this gets really good. When we say balance, let me say it again. We are not When we say balance, we are not talking about balancing law with grace or performance with grace. When we talk about balance, we're talking about the balance between grace, what God did, and faith, which is my part, which is receiving, not earning. Amen? Therefore, being justified by faith, Romans 5:1, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith, which is believing what he did, into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. On and on it goes. So faith is my part. Faith is my positive response to what God has already provided by grace. God does not override your free will or your free choice. Amen? But I want to say the question again, because we are going to answer it. What about sin? Because people have this question. People come to me and say, well, if I'm under grace, then I just go, I can just do whatever, and God's not going to throw you out. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. But we know natural consequences. You can destroy your life. But here's my question. Does anything occur in the spirit if I live a life of perpetual sin, yes or no? If you say yes, I'm going to ask you what? Renee knows. But we're going to prove it from the scripture. We're going to prove it from the scripture. Amen? Something does occur. Let me say this to you. Now, somebody could say, oh, you're categorizing sin. There's a difference between me having a crossword with my wife than me living a perpetual adulterous affair behind her back. The difference is not with God. The difference is with me. Are you hearing? And the Lord showed me something else. When you address these things, that's not preaching on sin. That's showing people what Christ did. Are you hearing? All right. So what did I say? There we go. And now I stand and am a judge. This is Paul talking for the hope of the promise made by the Father, by God to our fathers. Next verse. No. 26. Chapter 20, verse 26. My bad. That's good though too. Acts chapter, there we go. Therefore I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all men. This is the Apostle Paul. Next verse. For I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God. Stop. The whole counsel of God. The whole counsel of God. Many people, they're just getting, they think grace is just freedom from the law. And they don't understand who they are. They don't understand their new identity. Grace empowers the very fact that you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. The Bible says in Romans chapter 6 that you were the servants or slaves of sin, New King James. Now you're the slave of righteousness and you have your fruit unto holiness. Holiness is a byproduct. Holiness is separation from and separation to. Separation from the corruption that's in the world, separated to God. You have your fruit unto holiness. Holiness is a fruit of your new nature, not a root to your new nature. Everybody got that? Now watch, this is going to get gooder. Paul said, I'm free from the blood of all men because I have not shunned to declare unto you the whole counsel. Balance is not mixing law with grace. Balance is showing you that God did everything, but you have to receive the everything. That's your part. It's called faith. Everybody got that? Remember the question, because we will get to it. We will get to it, and we will show you. And Paul said some things. Who? Paul. The Pauline revelation. Paul's wife, you know Pauline. I love saying that. I'm sorry. So Paul said, I have not shunned to declare unto you the whole counsel of God. Next verse. Therefore take heed to yourselves and to all the flock. In other words, look out. Among which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God which he had purchased with his own blood. Next verse. For I know this, that after my departure, this is what Paul's saying. I know that when I leave, after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you. Whoa! Savage wolves. This is part of declaring the whole counsel of God. I was praying in the Holy Ghost, and I was thinking about, yeah, you know, preach the cross, don't address areas of error. And you know what the Lord showed me? I was pacing in the Holy Ghost. He said, well, then Jesus had it wrong. Paul had it wrong. James had it wrong. Peter had it wrong. Jude had it wrong, because they all warned, beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was need for me to write unto you to exhort you that you would earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered to the saints. For there are certain men crept in unawares who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness, license, lack of empowerment, absence of restraint. That's not the grace of God. You are in charge. You know, everything God says to do in the New Testament is an identification of who you are. It's saying, this is who you are. You don't have to steal anymore. You don't have to be depressed. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Paul was in prison when he wrote that. Whew. And we think, because it's cloudy, I have a right to be depressed. You're a master, man. Stand up within who you are and begin to declare, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. I don't have to be depressed. I don't have to fall apart like a $2 suitcase when something doesn't go my way. I'm in charge because he made me in charge. I'm one with him. Glory to God. Man, that's good news. See, when I see that, man, you mean, God, I don't have to be offended? No. Then I guess I won't. They'll come in among you, Paul said, not sparing the flock. Next verse. Also from among your own selves will men rise up, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after themselves. There's the motive. Next verse. Therefore watch and remember that for 3 years, three, count them, years. 1, 2, 3. 3 years. I'm thinking, Paul, get a grip. I mean, let's go on. Let's talk about the fun stuff. Paul said, for 3 years I warned you. The Lord showed me something recently. Last week I told my wife, it just flew out of my mouth. I know it was the Holy Ghost. He said, many people mistake the gospel for a nice delivery. In other words, because the preacher smiles and he's nice, they think that's the gospel. No, not necessarily. I mean, I'm all for that. I think we should smile. I think we should be happy. All that stuff's great. But just because someone smiles and they're happy doesn't mean the delivery's not necessarily the message. But a lot of people don't know the difference. Well, he's nice. He didn't cuss me out like my last pastor. They don't cuss you out with cuss words. They use Christian words. Remember, 3 years I did not cease to warn everyone night and day with tears. Next verse. So, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all them who are sanctified. But isn't that interesting? Paul was concerned. See, nobody can stop you. You're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Man, if you just keep focus on that and you go for, let me say this to you. This is on my heart. This must be God. Go to Romans 1:21. I want to show you this. Romans 1:21. Because that although they knew God, or when they knew God, they did not glorify me as God, nor were thankful, but became futile or vain in their imagination or thoughts, and their foolish heart was darkened. Now watch this. I want to say one thing. These people knew God. You know what happened? Are you ready? You know what happened? The first thing, I'm not even going to go. I'm just going to do one thing. They didn't glorify God. Do you know what it means to glorify God? You know what it means? Are you ready? Give weight to the things of God. When you realize that the gospel message is more important than the air you breathe, you start giving weight to it. Amen? See, this is a challenge. Come up hither. You cannot lose. But we think, oh, it doesn't really matter. We know people, Jen and I, we know people, oh, well, you know, it don't really matter. They got a bigger Ferris wheel than, you know, it don't matter what you hear, bless God. It matters. If it's not new covenant, run like a scalded dog. And that's not just in church attendance. That's in my daily life. Glorify him. The most important thing in the absolute world is my relationship with Jesus Christ. That's it. And the more weight I give to it, the more real it becomes to me. It's already real, but the more real it becomes in my life. See, this is our part. It's called faith. We receiving, present tense, the abundance of grace. Not just grace, the abundance of grace. And that we receiving the gift that we have, the gift of righteousness, we will reign in life by one Jesus Christ. Glory to God, that's good stuff. Now, to our balance is not a bad word. So glorifying him means giving weight to the things of God. Next verse, go to Ephesians 5:15. Yes, and I want to share this one with you from the Greek. Ephesians 5:15. Watch this. This is amazing. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. Now, a fool in Scripture is somebody who trusts in their own understanding. That's what God calls a fool. The wisdom of this world, the Bible says, is foolishness with God. See, a true, the reverence or the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, it says in Proverbs. It also says it's the beginning of wisdom. I was in a grocery store one time reading my little Gideon New Testament, and all of a sudden I thought, wow, a lot of people in the world haven't even begun. See, success is not how much stuff you have. Success is knowing him. I'm one of the most successful people I know. The more I know him, the more success manifests. And has nothing. Now, God cares about your outward circumstances, but there's a lot of people with outward circumstances that are good, but they're on more medication than you can shake a stick at. That's not prosperity. And I'm not trying to say there's anything wrong with medication. That's not what I'm saying. If you need it, use it. But see then that you walk circumspectly. This literally means balanced. Now watch this. I looked this up. Watch this. I remember one Greek expositor saying it means walk right down the middle of the road. And here, watch this. It says, see then you walk circumspectly, which means exactly, accurately. It means strict conformity to a norm or a standard. That standard is Christ. It means to live carefully, no deviation in respect to this standard. The word fools means somebody who's unwise. That's what the word fools means. Okay, so here it is. The Bible says in Proverbs 11:1 that a false balance is an abomination to the Lord. A false balance. This is the heart cry of both my wife and I. We want to see people get grace and grace get them. Empower you. I was on that last week. You know how when you dwell in God, you're dwelling in love. He is love. And that love is manifesting on behalf of other people. If I'm looking for an excuse to sin, what's wrong with my heart? What's wrong with my understanding? You know, if people think we're light on sin, you know what I tell them? Look at the cross. Look at what Jesus went through. As great as that movie, what's that movie? The Passion of the Christ is, I don't believe that did justice what Jesus went through. His visage was so marred beyond human recognition. That's what he went through for you and I. That's what he took that you and I deserved. So people think, oh, sin doesn't matter. Well, then what about the cross? What about the cross? Now, before we get into this question, this is the question. First of all, when we say balance, let me say this. I'll say it again. We are not talking about mixing your performance with his grace. That's not balance. That's mixture, and that'll kill you. But when we talk about balance, we're saying God did everything. My part is faith, which is receiving what God did. Amen? Do you know I believe in filling up? How many of you drive a vehicle of any kind? Whether it's a moped or a 18-wheeler. Do you know you need fuel in that vehicle? You know when the Bible says, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess or unsaveness, but be filled with the Spirit, Ephesians 5? You know that's a commandment? You know, if I think I may have said this last week, if my vehicle runs out of fuel, it's still a car. But it ain't going anywhere. Amen? It's not going to get me to my destination if I don't put fuel in it. That's the same way it is with the things of God. If you don't fill up through relationship with him, your vehicle's not going to run real well. In fact, it's not going to run at all. Amen? Say, I have a part. My part is not earning. My part is receiving. Present tense, receiving not just grace, but the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, you will reign in life by Christ Jesus. Isn't that powerful? All right, that's good news. So This is why the ministry of the Holy Spirit is so vital and so necessary and so very important. Okay, let's start where I want to start. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 through 6, we'll do from the New King or the Amplified, and then verses 7 through 11. That's what we'll do, 7 through 11 from the New King James. Is that all right? I'm doing it anyhow. All right. 1 John chapter 2, from the Amplified, verse 1. First six verses from the Amplified. Verse 1. I know we're still getting in sync here with this new, the different translations. Verse number 1. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. That's verse 11. That's good too. Hey, my little children, these things write I to you so that you may not sin. Now, God loves you whether you sin or not. We'll cover that in the rest of this verse. But his desire, sin means to miss the mark or to come short. Let's think, it means to come short of the glory of God. Hamartia, I've heard it pronounced hamartia, whatever you want to say. But it means to miss the mark. We know that definition, but it means to come short of the glory of God. You could say it like this. It means to come short of who you really are. You got that? So, all right, watch this. Now it says, and if anyone sins, we have an advocate, an attorney, if you will, with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Next verse. And he himself is the propitiation. That's a fancy word for the atoning sacrifice, the mercy seat, the satisfaction for our sins. In other words, he's covered them all. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world, is what that should say. Also for the whole world. So in other words, let me stop here. Let me say something. Jesus died for every sin in the world. But that doesn't mean every sin, everybody receives that, okay? Jesus died for all the sins of the world, but everybody doesn't receive that. Amen? Well, we got that. All right, now, moving right along, verse 3. Now, by this we know that we know him. How do I know if I know him? Oh, he's going back under the law. Hey, this is in 1 John. This is a New Testament epistle. This is not talking about keeping the Ten Commandments. It's not talking about keeping the law. Well, what commandments is he talking about? Let me read the verse and then we'll talk about it. I'm going to show you what he's talking about. Watch this. Here's how we know that we know him. How do I know if a person knows him? Jesus said in Matthew 7, referring to the new covenant, he said, you're going to know these people by the fruits in their life. Do you know how I tell a honeysuckle bush? By the berries. I see the leaves. When I see the berries, I think, that's a honeysuckle. I just learned that, by the way. I'm not real versed on all that, but I'm learning. Now, by this, we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Let's go another verse, and then I'll show you his commandments. He that says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments is in error, is a liar. That's what John says. And the truth is not in him. Now, what are his commandments in the New Testament? Whew. That's law. No, it's not law. You have his laws written in your heart and mind. What are his commandments in the new covenant? Is it keeping the 613 commandments under the Mosaic law? Absolutely not. That's what people say. That's not it. He answers it in this same book. Okay, we'll come right back to this verse, verse 4. Jump over to 1 John 3, 23 and 24, the last two verses. 1 John, and this is his commandment. Here it is. Singular. Everybody say singular. This is it. That we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. Now, wait a minute. That sounds like two commandments, doesn't it? It's one twofold commandment. All right? If you really, see, believing on Jesus isn't just saying, yeah, I believe on God. I believe there's a God. You know, the Bible says in James chapter 2, verse 19, thou believest there is one God. The devils also believe and tremble. I call it devil faith. When people believe and they have an unhealthy fear of God, like God's going to strike them down or kill them, I call that devil faith. A lot of people have that because when you're under the law, you're always told you never measure up. When you're under the new covenant, you're always told that Jesus measured up for you and you're in him. But he said, but even though I'm in the new covenant, I still can decide that I'm going to be a jerk. The Bible says in Galatians chapter 5, I want to say about verse 13 or so, he says, brethren, you've been called to liberty or freedom. Only use not your liberty for an occasion or a starting point for the flesh, but by love, which is God, Christ in you, the hope of glory, who you are in your new nature. But by love, serve one another. By love, serve one another. Not by law, by love. By who you are. Glory to God. I'm getting excited. I'm trying to hold myself down. Watch this. So this is his commandment. Believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. Singular. Next verse. Plural. Next verse. Verse 24. Now he who keeps his commandments. See that? Plural. It was singular in the verse 4. Abides in him. Abides. Meno. Stays in him. Keeps their faith in him and what he did. See, the scripture would not tell me to abide in him if there wasn't the potential to drift away. Do you know the whole time people are talking? Throughout every day, there's multiple voices coming at us. This is why I said, give way to the things of God. It's life and death. Oh, it doesn't matter. He loves you, whatever you do. Like someone said, you know, you can do whatever. If you're born again, you'll still go to heaven. In fact, you'll get there a lot quicker, a whole lot quicker. Amen. But then you won't be able to further the kingdom in this earth, because you know God uses you. If we fail to find out who we are, God's will is tied up. That's why Satan loves religion. He loves it. Because if I can just get people to believe wrong, they will do wrong. See, if we knew better, we'd do better. If we knew who we was more in Christ, it would produce better actions. Now watch this. Now he who keeps his commandments abides in him, and he in him. What were his commandments? One, twofold, believe on his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. That's what Jesus said. We talked about it last week, John 13:34. I'm giving you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. They couldn't do that under the old covenant. They didn't have the potential to truly love. It was just based on, you do me good, I like you. If not, I don't. Amen? So, okay. And by this we know that he abides in us. Here's how we know: by the Spirit whom he hath given us. See, I think of what Charlie told me. He says, you know, he started telling me, he said, we just want to do this. It's just the right thing to do. We just know. How do you know that? I didn't say nothing. I don't tell people what to do. I just point them to Jesus. And if they'll let the Holy Spirit direct, you know what to do. I was in a Christian bookstore, my wife and I recently, and there was some book on about hearing the voice of God. I thought, wait a minute, I hear the voice of God. When you prioritize his word, I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit quickens the voice of God to you. You know the voice of God. Well, I just didn't know I wasn't supposed to shoot that person. Trust me, you knew. You knew. Go back to, if you would please, to 1 John 2, verse 4, and we'll probably shoot into verse 5, because I got to hurry up and get to the question. Oh boy, do I got to hurry. Amazing. Who says, I know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar and the truth is not in him. We just looked at it. Not the old covenant, new covenant. Next verse. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him, or made complete in him, in his walk, in his experience. By this we know that we are in him. Next verse. That's how we know. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked. In other words, if I'm telling you that I'm abiding in him, that I'm born again and that I'm abiding in him, then my walk ought to be consistent with what I say. Do you know God will never exalt a person, ministry, business, or anything above their character? Never. But you know why? Because he loves you, loves you, loves you. You know, Joel has been, he's 9, he'll be 10 in January, been pulling the van around. Some of you see that? But guess what? He's not taking it to Dayton. I know what you're thinking. Man, Chris, yeah, you are so mean. I'm not mean. I love him, and I love the other people on the road. Amen? But he is practicing, and that's all good. But see, God never exalts a person above their character. Never. Why? Because he loves you. And guess what? None of us, we're all developing in our character. Oh, no, it's all, you know, people, there's a lot of what I call finished work foolishness. It isn't finished work, it's stupid work. Sorry, I was venting. It's not finished work at all. Finished work does not deny your development as an individual and your development and your understanding of what Jesus did. Amen? See, I used to think I was ready to conquer the world. Now I think, you know what? He's conquered the world for me. I'll just look at him and have a relationship and let him do whatever he wants to do. It's that simple. It's called rest, R-E-S-T. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked. Verse 7 from the Amplified, please. I know I'm challenging you. Amplified. This is so good. Huh. Is that the one I want in Amplified? No. New King James. I'm sorry. My bad. New King James. I was messed up on that. Brethren, I write no new commandment to you. In other words, this isn't new, but an old commandment which you have heard from the beginning. Now he's going to tell you the difference between the old commandment and the new commandment. Say there's a difference. And watch this. I haven't forgot the question. Don't worry. Watch this. I'm not writing a new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you have heard from the beginning. The old commandment was the word. Let me say it to you this way. Murdering people is wrong under the old covenant. It's still wrong under the new covenant. Stealing is wrong under the old covenant. It's still wrong under the new covenant. Adultery, lying, all that stuff, it's wrong under both covenants. But why is he calling the word an old covenant, and then he's talking about a new covenant? He'll tell you right here in a minute. All right, watch this. It says, so the old commandment is the word which you have heard from the beginning. Next verse. Again, a new commandment I write to you. Here it is. This is it. Remember Jesus said, what did he say in John 13:34? I'm giving you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Now watch this. I write to you, which thing is true in him and in you. You're born again. Born again, that's Southern for born again. Born from above. You're born again. See, this command, this is true because it's in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you. See, we think, oh, that means his whole job's to make me feel good. It's all about me. I don't care how selfish I am. Christ in you. No. Heavens, no. You're there to be a blessing. Amen? You know the greatest, my wife and I, we were talking about, where do we get this idea that God's only interest is our having fun? In his presence is fullness of joy. At his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. You want to have fun? Put him first. Amen. Hallelujah. I say it all the time. You don't need things to enjoy life. You need life to enjoy things, because then things don't matter. Because you have life. His name is Jesus. So a new commandment I write to you, which thing is true. Say is. In him and in you. Because why? The darkness is passing away, and the true light is already shining. In other words, the reality of this commandment has to do when you realize that the darkness is passing away. You're growing. You're growing. Ah, people, I don't like that. You're growing. Amen. No, I got to hurry. Next verse. He who says he is in the light and hates his brother, literally means despises his brother, is in darkness until now. Isn't that something? I love what Pam said. I used to hate this. I love her now. That's God. That's God. Amen? Two more verses, and then we got to get to something else. He who loves his brother abides. This is why he abides in the light. God is light. There's no darkness in him. He abides in God. It's automatic. You can't abide in God and hate. You know, anybody got any jerks in their life? Don't look at your neighbor. Just look straight ahead and raise your hand. Just got George. Don't look at Renee. No, I'm teasing. He brings it out of me. It's his fault. Okay. So, but this is why. Because he abides in the light. And there's no cause for stumbling in him. You ever been try to walk through a dark room at a high speed? Don't. I've learned. Go to the restroom like this. I think I know where everything's at, but you never know. All right. Next verse. But he who hates his brother is in darkness. He walks in darkness, does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Now go to 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. We're getting to our question. We have time. I'm going to be able to answer it in the name of Jesus. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. I appreciate them doing that back there. Isn't that good? This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light. In other words, if the light's on, I can see, right? And in him is no darkness. Next verse. if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, what do we just see? Darkness has to do with hating my brother. And watch this. We lie and do not practice the truth. In other words, I can't say I'm walking in the light, but I can hate everybody else. That's impossible. It's impossible. So here's what we're not telling you. We're not telling you to go out and try to love people. We're telling you who we are and walk in the light of who you are. See, God's light does not reveal your sins. It reveals what's right with Christ in you, the hope of glory. When you walk in the light, you start seeing who you are, and the automatic response is you love people. That doesn't mean you hang out with everybody. We got to get rid of the world's definition of love. All right, next verse. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship. This is what I'm after. We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses, present tense, us from all sin. Now stop. Stop. So if I'm walking in the light as he is in the light, I have fellowship with my brethren. And then why does he throw that in? His blood's cleansing me from all sins. I thought they were all gone. I dug myself in, didn't I? Well, I'm going to have to dig out. Once again, let me say this to you. Just being in this physical body, I don't do everything right. I know you do, but I don't. Word, thought, or deed, there's times I make mistakes. And I'm going to say this. When you say, are you categorizing sin? Yeah, absolutely, I'm categorizing sin. Not on God's part, but on my part. See, if I'm walking in the light, just the human frailties and conditions, that blood is ever flowing. But there's a difference when I turn my back on God and I choose not to abide in him. God still loves me, and God will let me destroy my life. He will. He will never leave me nor forsake me. All that stuff is true, but there's a difference. Not only with natural consequences, there's a difference in the spirit. Now it's really quiet in here. Let's prove it from the Bible quickly. I'm going to hurry up. Genesis chapter 1, verse 24, 25, and 26. Genesis chapter 1. Watch this. Why, if I'm under grace, then why don't I just go out and live like I want? Well, it's not who you are. You're denying your new nature. But why does it matter? Why does it matter? Are you ready? We're going to show you, and then I'm going to go to the writings of Paul. Why was sin so bad? Does anybody know? Why was sin so bad? Because sin separated man from God. Now, that's why Jesus dealt with the sin problem, so we would never be separated from God, right? Right? Now, watch this. So if I'm never separated from God, then, hey, do what? Do whatever, right? Listen, if you're a new creation, you want to do right. Now, okay, but that's... Then said God, this is the creation. Let the earth bring forth the living creatures according to its kind, cattle and creeping thing and beast of the earth according to its kind. And it was so. Next verse. And God made the beast of the earth according to its kind, cattle according to its kind, and everything that creeps on the earth according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Next verse. Then God said, let us make man in our image. Like begets like. Now watch this. Let us make man in our image according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing. You have dominion over creeps. That creeps on the earth. All right? So God made man in his image. So what happened when man sinned? We already said that. Man was united with God and he became separate from God. But here's what I want you to see. God, now let man have what? Look at that word, dominion. Dominion. God gave man dominion. Dominion. That means you're in charge. So when man sinned, he became separated from God and he lost his dominion. So when here, some of you are going to struggle with this. I'm going to try to prove it in less than 7 minutes. I'm going to really try to prove this. When I live a perpetual life of sin, even though God doesn't abandon me, I turn my back on him. And I'm not abiding in him. And what I do is I give the dominion that I have over sin, I'm going to prove it to you from Paul's writings, I give that dominion that he gave me over sin, I give it away to a defeated foe called sin. That's what happens. God still loves you. Hey, he'll never leave you nor forsake you. You are under grace. Well, take that back. You're under law. That's why sin's dominating you. Are you ready? Let me show it to you. This is why Paul said, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. I'm going to read these definitions. I read them last week. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. Watch this. Everybody say Paul's writings. Thank you. Paul's writing. All things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful. The old King James says expedient. All things are lawful for me. Watch this. But I will not be brought under the power of anything. I will not allow anything, exousia, to be a master over me, like something that's defeated called sin. Do you know people that, there's many things you could say, but people that consistently yield to a life that's contrary to God, they get into bondage? How many guys are in bondage to internet porn? Christians, come on. Come on. No, sorry. It's the truth, because it's bondage. And when you yield to those things, you need to know God's not condemning you, but I'm telling you it's bondage. And you'll come under bondage to that. Well, no, I just, took this drug or whatever, and then they're in bondage to it. That's what Paul said. Hey, man, you do whatever, but I'm telling you, if you allow yourself, you can become in bondage. Look at the word exousia. I shared this last week. This is amazing. It means to be a master of anyone. It means to exercise authority over one. In other words, I'm not going to let anything exercise authority over me. And when, it could be food. That's an accepted mastery in America. See, I'm not going to let any. I love what my wife says. I'm a master. We went to a party for Reese yesterday, a Christmas party, and Jen didn't eat. And somebody said, is your wife on a diet? No, she's not hungry. Imagine that. Oh, you got it. No, you don't. You're in charge, man. He made you a master. Hallelujah. Look at this. Some of the other definitions. Power. It means power of choice. I will not let anything have power of choice over me. It means liberty of doing as one pleases. I will not let a defeated foe called sin have the liberty of choice upon me because I'm in charge. He put me in charge. I'm in him. He's in me. I'm dwelling in him. Well, I don't feel like loving. It's in your heart. It's up to you. You can say, and I'm not going to listen. I'm going to do my own thing and abide outside of him. Or you can say, you know what? This is who's in me. I'm going with who I am. Boy, this is good news. Hallelujah. Let me give you another one. It means to control. Paul's saying, I will not allow anything to control me. That's what he's saying. Nothing. Now watch this. Romans chapter 6, verses 12 through 16. We got 3 minutes and something. Hallelujah. Everybody say, grace empowers who you are in him, who he is in you. Watch this. Oh, I got to get to these. First Romans chapter 6. What did I say? Verse 12. Yeah, I think that's what I want. Verse 12. Romans, therefore, back up to verse 8. We'll just start verse 8. It's all good. Romans 6, 8. Watch this. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Next verse. Next. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more, death no longer has any dominion over him. Death, remember death, separation from God, has no dominion over you. You're not separated from God. You're united with God. You're one with him because of Jesus. Next verse. For the death that he died to sin once for all. but the life he lives to God. Next verse, here it's getting gooder. Likewise you also, reckon yourselves to be dead indeed. Look at that, to sin. Reckon, logazomai, I believe is the Greek word. It's an accounting term. It means count it this way. You're dead to it. How can I function in something that's dead in my life? Amen. Now, I'm not here again. I'm walking in the light as he is in the light. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses me from all human frailties and shortcomings. But to choose a life that's separate from him, barring all the crazy natural consequences, guess what? I'm not going to give my authority to something that's defeated. Hang with me. It's getting gooder. I'm so excited. So let me leave that up there. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Next verse. Here we go. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body. It's talking, it's a noun, it's a singular noun. Don't let a nature that's defeated and taken out of the way and died in him, don't let it reign in your body. How foolish. That you should obey it in its lust. Next verse. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. What are your members? Your eyes, your hands, your mouth, your nose, your mind. Don't present this as instruments to unrighteousness, to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Next verse. For sin shall not have dominion over you. The word dominion means reign as a king over you. It can't reign as a king over you because Jesus whipped it. That's why it said he died unto sin once. He ain't dying to sin again. Whew. For you are not under law, but you are under something, grace. So people that live a lifestyle perpetually contrary to God and they say they're under grace, they're not under grace. They're being dominated by sin. I know a lot of people think, oh, you know, we heard one thing on the internet one time. The only sin there is forgiven sin. That sounds good, but you better explain it. Amen. There's a lot of foolishness that's being espoused as the gospel, and it's not the gospel. It's just what Jude warned about. They're turning the grace of God into license. Thank you, Jen. For you are not under the law, but under grace. Next verse, verse 15. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? Certainly not. God forbid. Next verse. Look at this. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey? Who you, believer, born again child of God, if you present yourselves as slaves to obey this? You know, when we were in kids, they'd always have the anti-drug things would come in and they would say, you know, it starts out small and smoking pot, and then it goes to this and that. And that may not be for everyone, but it was for a lot of people. Ruin their lives. Ruin their lives. Because you yield to that and you become in bondage to it. I heard another story. A man was talking about that, I think it was a BBC or whatever, was doing interviews in Las Vegas of these people that were losing thousands of dollars at these slot machines and all that stuff. And then all of a sudden they'd win a couple hundred dollars. And they say, see, I'm winning. But they were losing thousands. That's bondage. And if you're born again, he broke that power, but you can still yield to it. Amen? But you don't have to, because greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. And see, that stuff will bring you into, I'm going to show you another one. 1 Peter 2:11, not yet, but I just want to finish this, but get ready for that one. Do you not know that to whom you present yourself slaves to obey, you are that one slaves whom you obey, whether of sin, a defeated nature. I'm going to get into that too. Do we have a sin nature? Not today. Whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness. And obedience means hearing under. So don't you know that who you yield yourselves servants to obey, you become enslaved to that person. That's why Jesus said over in John chapter 8 before the cross, he told them, saying, hey, we're Abraham's seed. And you know what Jesus said? He said, listen, the person who lives in sin, it's because they're enslaved to it. That's their nature. They can't help it. But if you know the Son, he'll set you free. So I'm here to tell you, you're free. You're free. You're free. You're in charge. But if I yield to something that's been defeated, you know, if I start trying to raise cobras in my house, not a good idea. Not a good idea at all. All right, jump over to 1 Peter 2:11. Hallelujah. Oh, and I'm going to do another one. Okay, I got plenty of time. Beloved, I beg you. This is the Apostle Peter. I beg you. Paul said it in, I think it's 2 Corinthians 6:1. I beseech you, I beg you, don't receive the grace of God in vain or for naught or for nothing. But he said, I'm begging you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lust that war against your soul. Our kids are having a problem with bad dreams. What's the problem? We let them watch Freddy Krueger. We don't understand it. Duh. Oh, I got a problem with lust. What are you watching? Abstain from them. They're warring against your soul, man. Don't be to something that God sets you free from. Man, this is good preaching. I'm taking up an offering for me. Right there. All $2. I'm kidding. I beg you, abstain. They war against your soul. Now, one more. 1 Corinthians 9, verses 24 through 27 from the New American Standard Bible. And then we'll do Colossians chapter 2, verse 5 from the New American Standard. This is what, watch this. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24. This is a challenge, all these translations, so Here, this is powerful. New American Standard, please. There we go. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run? Now, this is the Pauline revelation, okay? This is the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul. This is not Leviticus. Okay? Do you not know that those who run in a race run all, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win. Run in such a way that, see, Christ already won. But what you do with what Christ has done determines your walk. It's called faith. Now, next verse. Everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control. I thought we were under grace. I thought we were under grace.
I knew it. The other shoe dropped. It was just a matter of time.
This is the whole counsel of God. This is grace. This is empowerment. Watch this. So they exercise self-control in all things. You know, I used to run cross country. And everybody has different levels of natural talent. You know, you had to be a runner, obviously, to some degree, or you wouldn't be on the team. Okay? But you know, we still trained. You know, the Bible says in 1 Timothy 4, exercise yourself to godliness. We still trained. Even though you were a runner, you're a whole lot better if you work at it. Michael Jordan was a phenomenal basketball player, but you know, he still worked at it too, which made him super phenomenal. He had the natural ability, but he still developed that natural ability. As a born-again child of God, you've got the righteousness of God in you, but you develop it. The Bible calls it fruits of righteousness. There's fruits that are a result of your right standing with God. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10. James chapter 3, verse 18. There's another one. Talks about the fruits of your righteousness. All right. Everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath or crown, but we an imperishable. Next verse. Therefore, I run in such a way as not without aim. In other words, I know, I understand New Covenant stuff. I box in such a way as not beating the air. In other words, I'm not just doing stuff to be doing stuff. Amen? I don't just read the Bible because they tell you got to read the Bible. Some people, I tell them, don't read the Bible. Not yet. Or just read here for now because you'll have all kinds of laws and you won't have a clue that it's about Jesus. Next verse. But I discipline my body. Now, let me say this to you. Do we have a sin nature? I know some people teach we do. No. But you do have a body, a mortal body, that's been given to you by the first Adam, and it's very capable of sin. The very core of your nature is new nature. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation, it says in 2 Corinthians 5. So you have that life in you, the life of God. Paul said, I thank my God whom I serve with my spirit. That life is empowering. We through the spirit mortify the deeds of this mortal body, it says in Romans chapter 8, verse 11. So with that said, see, I discipline my body. In other words, I don't let it do everything it wants to do. It's like the spoiled little kid. I'm not dead. I don't want to pray. So what? You know, I find that when you allow him to fill you, I'm telling you, I see so much stuff. I get so excited. I can't hardly stand it. I used to look out at days like this when it was dreary and feel that little twinge of depression. Sometimes I feel constant internal overpowering joy welling up from my inner man. And that's not because God just likes me more than some people. It's because I let him fill me up. Amen. I spend time in the Word. I spend time praying in the Holy Ghost, allowing him to fill me to overflowing. Is it to earn anything? No, it's just to realize what I've already got in Christ. I'm trying to quit, so hang with me. I discipline my body and I make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified. This is not talking about Paul going to hell, but he's saying, I won't receive all that my righteous stand in him has made available. Amen? Paul's born again. It's not talking about God sending him to hell. But he said, I'm not going to receive the things I'm preaching you if I just allow my body to go nuts. Are you hearing this? Is this too deep? See, sometimes people like the part, well, you know, oh, we're under grace. I don't have to go to church. Fire me up. It's the truth. You don't have to do anything. You are something. You're a whole lot greater than other people, what others have said about you. Amen. Now go to Colossians 2, verse 5, and we will close with this from the New American Standard, please, because I love this verse. love this verse. Being disciplined is not legalism. The only time discipline becomes legalism is if you're trying to take your discipline and use it as a currency between you and God. In other words, Lord, I prayed, so you bless me now because I prayed, I earned it, I deserve it. That's legalism. But when you use it as a discipline, I call it flesh stakes. When you use your discipline and say, no, body, I tell you what to do. I buffet you. I used to think that meant buffet you, but I'm learning as I grow. I love this verse. Has anybody got an easy boy? I love this verse from the New American Standard. Watch this. Paul says, for even though I am absent in the body, talking to the saints at Colossae, nevertheless, I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your sloppy agape, your greasy grace, your lack of understanding of what grace really is. I just love it because God is love. Go ahead, Johnny, play on the freeway. Love, stupidity. I am with you in spirit. I'm rejoicing to see your good discipline, which produces a stability in your faith with Christ. Hallelujah. I literally crave my prayer times. Oh, Chris, there you go. The Bible says praying without ceasing. I got it, Jack. But that means being in constant communion with him. But Jesus got up a great while before day and departed into a solitary place and there prayed. He had communion with his Father. He got filled up. Mark 1:35. Oh, it's good news. It's good news. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Not work for, work out. Not work for, work out. Hear the difference? For it is God that's working in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Just like when they said to me, you know what? We just need to get married. Now, how did they know that? Have I ever preached on that? Not that I know of.
Yes, you did, Chris, 2 weeks ago.
Isn't it powerful? The gospel's the power. It's the power of God unto salvation. The word salvation doesn't mean just when you die and go to heaven and not hell. Salvation means deliverance in every area. But let me finish this. So I'm rejoicing to see your good discipline and the stability of your faith resting in Christ. See, everything wants you, feelings want you to put your faith in them. Well, I don't know that God's here. I didn't feel him. You know, he's here whether I feel him or not. Did you know that? You know what I like about doing the honeybees? God's with me. He likes it. He laughs when I get stung. I'm kidding. He doesn't. He's with me all the time. And so, but my good discipline produces, because I'm disciplined, it produces a stability, my faith in Christ. One more. I wasn't going to do this one. Jump over to Hebrews chapter 5, verses 12 through 14. Probably New American Standard. We'll try that one. Hebrews 5. I love this. 12. Can we back up to 12? And then that's the end of the chapter. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you have need again that someone to teach you the elementary principles of the oracles of God. And you have come to need milk and not solid food. Next verse. For everyone who partakes only of milk is not accustomed to the word of righteousness. Leave that up there. For everyone who only partakes of milk, he's not accustomed to the word of righteousness. In other words, he hasn't been here in the new covenant. So that's why he just takes milk. And we had one person one time, what'd they say? Well, I think Chris is preaching legalism because he's talking about things we do. Moving right along. So he's not accustomed to the word of righteousness, for he is an infant. Next verse. But solid food, or strong meat, the old King James says, is for the mature, who because of practice or habit, old King James says use, it means habit or practice. Because of practice. Are you hearing my point? Have their senses. Woo! Trained to discern good and evil. Notice it's not discern good from evil, but to discern the good and discern the evil. Sometimes because something looks good doesn't mean it's good. You have to discern. What is discernment? It's the ability to interpret what you see and hear. But notice it's because of practice, because of relationship. You know, if you've been married, I can tell sometimes what my wife's thinking, and she can tell what I'm thinking. You know how? Because we've been together. We've had lots of practice knowing each other. So now I know what you're thinking. I can tell by the look on your face. You know, they say people that have married for years, they start looking like each other. I'm praying that Jen keeps her hair. But you know, why is that? It's familiarity. You get familiar. And so when we practice through relationship, even our senses become in line and trained. They become in line with our born-again spirit. In other words, they're not controlling us. Most of the time, people are led by their senses. What I see, what I hear, what I taste, what I smell, feel, all that type of stuff, rather than being led by their spirit. But how does it come? It doesn't come by osmosis. It comes by relationship. God loves you no matter what you do. But when I yield to a perpetual lifestyle that's contrary to him, I'm giving my authority. All things are lawful, but I will not be mastered by anything, especially something called sin that Christ defeated. Does that help you? Just say yes. Thank you. I'll call mom up and she'll say yes. But you didn't hear it, mom. It doesn't matter. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Say, I'm blessed, highly favored, deeply loved. I'm in charge. He put me in charge. Sin does not dominate me. I'm not under the law, but I'm under grace. Therefore, I dominate sin. Sin is defeated in my life. It's a done deal in Jesus' name. Amen. You're blessed. Yes, if anybody here, if you're not born again and you want to be, it all starts there. You must be born again. You must be translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. See, some people say, well, I just don't have any desire for those things. You probably need to be born again. Because once you're born again, as newborn babes, you desire the sincere, the pure, literally the spiritual milk of God's word. You have a craving for it because it's now your nature. So if anybody here, you're not born again, you want to be. Going once. If you want to see me after service, we're going to take about 20 minutes to a half hour, and then we're going to watch Charlie and Pam get married. Hallelujah. You're blessed. Have a great week. Hallelujah.